I'd like to call to order the City of Newport Beach Planning Commission for Thursday, November 3rd, 2016. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call.
All commissioners present, with the exception of Commissioner Dunlap and Commissioner Ketting, who are excused this evening.
Public comments. Public comments are invited on non-agenda items generally considered within the subject matter jurisdiction of the Planning Commission. Speakers must limit comments to 3 minutes. Before speaking, please state your name for the record and print your name on the blue forms provided at the podium. Request for continuances.
Chair Kramer, item number 4, which is the Dawson residence, that item has been requested to be tabled by the applicant and will be noticed in the future at a proper time. We do request the commission to take action on this to table it.
Okay, I'll make a motion to table. Is there a second? All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Next item is consent items. Item number 1, minutes of October 20th, 2016. Is there a motion?
Make a motion to approve the minutes incorporating Mr. Mosier and Chair Kramer's comments.
I just wanted to add one more edit to my comments where I talk about no impacts. I want to say no CEQA impacts. So just add in CEQA. Yeah, I did. Yeah.
I will amend my motion accordingly.
Is there a second?
Yes.
Okay. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Motion carries. Next item is item number 2, the Gelson Supermarket Conditional Use Permit, PA 2015-214. Staff, do you have a presentation?
Yes, Chairman, members of the Planning Commission and public, this is a request by Gelson's Supermarket for a small eating establishment at Gelson's. The application was first reviewed by the Planning Commission on September 22nd, 2016. It was tabled and then for additional work by the applicant to provide additional details to the patio and to help iron out some of the issues with the parking that's there. Just as a recap, the Gelson's store is depicted here in this photograph here. There'll be a small patio that would be added in the front of the Gelson's store, and we've got some plans. I'll show you in a moment what that might look like. But basically, this is a small little restaurant, a little tapas restaurant, if you will. It's a conditional use permit to add the restaurant with the alcohol license. It would be a Type 41 license that they would be using, so it would authorize an eating and drinking establishment. So there's a little small dining area inside right now. It's a little cafe bar, a coffee bar, if you will. So that space that's already there will be converted into this dining area, and they'll also have an outdoor patio. About 56 seats, this hours of operation 11 to 9 p.m. We've got some off-site parking that the Gelson's provides at a nearby church on Pacific View Drive, 40 spaces, and that's based upon the number of employees that Gelson's have. There's also a parking waiver that would only apply to Sunday in this respect because we've got the off-site parking during the week. So we've got these additional conceptual plans that were put together. The applicant can, in their presentation, kind of outline and or address any questions the commission may have. This is the courtyard here at the shopping center, the Harborview Shopping Center. So we have Gelson's over here on the right-hand side, and this is the small patio that they're looking to put in. So this is the existing storefront that's there that I showed you in the very first picture, and this is the main entry right over here. And so the area that's there today is basically just paved. And so there would be a patio that would encircle this area. It's about 750 square feet, and obviously some seating in this area. And this little planter area here is an existing street light, if you will, or a light standard. So we have a small exit door for egress and emergency, but accessing the space would be from the inside of Gelson's. And so they have these photographs here to show kind of what this area might look like. And these photographs here are the actual plaza area there today. The Irvine Company has done some additional seating, additional areas, and they can describe what those are. But these are photographs of it today. They've gone through a small renovation. And the front door to Gelson's is right over here in this lower image, and the patio would be right here in the front. This is the floor plan that was submitted. And so here's, again, the front of the building and then the patio here. Now, there is a parking waiver on Sunday. We have off-site parking at a church down the street. It's about 1,000 square feet. You know, we have evaluated and we've provided findings and facts in support of those findings to support the continuation of this off-site parking arrangement. What we learned is that Gelson's has been providing off-site parking at this church since 1999, and it's been working quite effectively. And so with what we discovered is that the parking analysis that was done does work just fine. However, we do want to maintain that off-site parking arrangement, because if that off-site parking did cease to exist, then we would have an issue where we might have insufficient parking on-site, or we'd have employees potentially parking in the neighborhoods. And as you recall from the last meeting, we've got some issues with some parking on Crown Drive, which has been since rectified by Rogers Gardens. And so the conditions of approval do require an off-site parking agreement to be entered and consistent with the municipal code for 40 parking spaces. Those spaces are based, the number of spaces is based on the demand that Gelson's need and the number of employees that they have. And that would provide assurance that those spaces would be there in perpetuity, if you will. And if they lose that parking, then they would have to basically curtail and take the patio and remove it. Staff does find that this relationship works. It's been in effect probably since 1999, and it's been working effectively. We feel that all the findings in the municipal code can be met to approve the use permit for the small restaurant, including the off-site parking and the parking waiver for Sunday. This is a church property, and they don't have access to the property on Sundays. And so what happens is they've used the school area, which is here. There's a parking area for Lincoln Elementary School, and there is some street parking. May not be the most ideal situation, but I think that it's been working effectively since 1999, and so this would waive the parking on Sunday, and the employees would be parking along in that space, or they also can park on site when parking demands at the property are diminished. So we do feel that the facts can support the findings, and we do recommend approval. The applicant is here, the Irvine Company is here. Answer any questions you may have on the conceptual designs or the parking arrangements. And that concludes my presentation.
The Irvine Company is here?
Yes.
Was Donald Bren here? Or is
he no, not no. Donald Bren.
Okay. God, I wish one of these nights he would show up. Okay, commission questions for staff. Okay, seeing none. Report of ex parte communications. I have not had any communications with the applicant. You got to say something.
I haven't had any communications with the applicant about this issue.
Nor have I.
Just minor email conversation, but nothing.
Okay. Let's open the public hearing. Does the applicant have a presentation? Please come forward and make sure the mic's on.
Good evening, commissioners. Brett Engstrom here on behalf of Gelson's Market. I believe this is a further clarification of our previous hearing to answer some additional questions that were posed that evening. We do believe we have all the answers you're looking for. Gelson's Market has been operating in that location since 1976. We are looking for three requests this evening. Primarily was a conditional use permit to allow the addition of a Type 41 and Type 86 license to the establishment. It would include a small cafe area, which is shown on the plan above you, for beer and wine on-site consumption. The second request is for the off-site parking agreement. As our friends from the planning department stated, we have had an off-site parking agreement with the Christian Science Church for approximately 65 spaces. However, our peak demand of employees at any given time is 40 employees. So we should have plenty of parking off-site. It's only 1,000 feet away. Our third request is the parking waiver for Sunday. As you can imagine, the church is busy on Sunday and the parking is unavailable. But per the parking study that we submitted, our most busy time is Thursdays in the middle of the day. So during the week, the middle of the day is when we are the busiest. We have off-site parking at that time. We do have members of the Irvine Company and Gelson's corporate team here. I think mainly you'll be hearing from Chuck Mayhew and Paulette Alexander. They can talk to you about the actual design details of the patio. If there are any questions about the alcohol licensing or the off-site parking agreement, I would love to answer those now.
I don't see any questions, so.
Great. Thank you, sir.
Yep. Thank you.
Good evening, Commissioners. Chuck Mayhew, Gelson's Market Construction Department. I want to see if you had any specific questions regarding the conceptual designs.
Okay.
Our goal is, as he expressed, that we want to enhance the area, deliver this wine bar, seating bar area. We think it's definitely going to be an improvement to the area. We want to follow the Irvine Company's design scheme that they already have in place. We're not looking to change the overall look of the center at all. We want to follow, again, their design, working with some of the same finishes, materials, umbrellas, and seating there. We hope that based on that, we're remaining in that original 700 square feet on the exterior patio. There's been no major changes since our original design concept. We're also trying to keep the original landscaping in place as well to soften up the area. Yeah, any questions?
I don't think so. I mean, I think this application is pretty self-explanatory. So, any other representatives from the applicant that want to speak?
Hi, my name's Paulette Alexander. I'm with Irvine Company. I work as a tenant coordination. I've been working with Gelson's very closely on the conceptual layout of the patio, and together we're working, you know, along with what we just recently enhanced the patio or the plaza area, and we will work closely with Gelson's on their final design.
Yeah, thank you. Any questions? Commissioner William?
Yes, I just had a quick question on the parking situation with the other tenants. I know it's not part of the application, but you know, there's a pizza place in there, there's Chinese food. You know, they'll be having patrons come around the same time. Is anyone else concerned about how the parking situation flows? I say we saw a positive letter from the stationery, but just has there been any discussion with any of the other restaurants that would have kind of the same type of clientele, maybe competing around that same hour?
Well, they're existing now, so we haven't had any issues with parking based on the parking study, so I don't think it's going to bring a lot more customers to the...
Okay, great. Thank you. All right, I think that's it. Thank you. We'll open up for general public comments. Please come forward. 3 minutes. No comments from the public? Okay. I will close the public hearing, bring it back to the commission. Is there a motion?
Brad? Sure, I'll make a motion. And I appreciate the work the applicant, Gelson's and Irvine Company have done to bring back a more comprehensive application. Very helpful. And wish you guys good luck. And I will, where is this thing? Adopt a resolution to be determined approving conditional use permit UP 2015-048.
Okay, is there a second?
I'll second.
All right, any further discussion? If not, call for the vote.
Motion carries 5-0.
Congratulations. Thank you. Next item is item number 3, the Village Inn outdoor dining use permit, PA 2015-016. Staff, do you have a presentation?
Good evening. The Planning Commission first considered this use permit as well as other entitlements back in December 2012. There have been some changes to the application, and I'd like to present those to you this evening. As a reminder, Village Inn is located on Balboa Island, and it is at the corner of Marine and Park Avenue.
It is in the mixed-use zone of Balboa Island, which is bordered by residential, which includes both single-family and duplex. Across the street from the Village Inn, shown here in red, is the fire station. Here's some photographs. The image at the top is the view from Park Avenue, and the images at the bottom are, I'm sorry, the top is from Marine Avenue, and the bottom is from Park Avenue. As you can see in the picture in the bottom right, there is a residential unit that's located on top of the restaurant use. As I mentioned, since the Planning Commission saw this back in 2012, there have been some changes. The first is we have eliminated the need for a land use amendment. As you recall, there was a proposal to merge this property with the adjacent property in an effort to remedy an existing encroachment that went beyond the subject property onto the residential lot. Instead of doing that approach, we decided to classify that encroachment as a legal nonconforming use. And as a result of that, it is subject to abatement. And that abatement proceedings, there was an extension that was filed by the applicant, and the hearing officer, who is the body to decide upon that issue, did review the application and made a decision today that the encroachment shall be abated within 10 years of the action being taken today, or that it may be extended at that time, or the land use change could occur. So the bottom line is the land use and the encroachment is not an issue that needs to be discussed by the Planning Commission. It has been resolved through a different avenue. The second, two acoustical analyses have been done. In 2015, the Planning Commission was confronted by several concerns from the residents that their existing concerns related to noise due to live entertainment. So the first analysis that was included in your staff report does analyze the impact of the live entertainment that is currently permitted. And that analysis did identify some measures to further attenuate the noise from the live entertainment itself and determined that it can be mitigated to a level of to comply with the current noise ordinance. The second analysis was actually submitted today, and that is subject to the project that's before you, and that is evaluation of the outdoor dining. And what that analysis did was evaluate what are the noise impacts as a result of opening up the front of the business, establishing a patio in that area with 16 seats, and the potential for the noise from inside the restaurant to emanate beyond the building. And that conclusion of that report did conclude that there was not any noise impacts. Lastly, the issue was related to the bike racks. You can see in the photo in the bottom right, there are existing bike racks that are located in the public right-of-way. And the question is, where can those bike racks go? Initially, we're looking at the adjacent property, but we've come to a better solution where the applicant is working with the Public Works Department, and I'll go over that in further detail with you later in the analysis. But basically, the bikes would be relocated as a result of this project. What's before you tonight is a conditional use permit for the ability for the business to establish outdoor dining along Marine Avenue. The total size would be 200 square feet. It would entail about 16 seats. It would be operate from the morning of 7 a.m. to 9 p.m., with the exception on weekends, meaning Friday and Saturday nights during the summer, between Memorial Day and Labor Day, federal holidays, and community events. The area would be required to be closed whenever live entertainment is offered. And lastly, the dining area is in the public right-of-way, so it would be subject to the City Council approval of what they call Policy L21. So the council would be the determining body, determine whether or not it is appropriate to be located in the right-of-way. The decision before the Planning Commission is truly whether or not the use is compatible with the neighborhood for the purposes of the use permit. Here is the floor plan of the restaurant. This also shows the residential use on the bottom where there are no changes proposed for that residential property. The changes proposed are only for the outdoor dining shown here in blue. I have shown a blown up image here as well as the photograph again. The dining area would maintain a sidewalk of a little over 6 feet, and the dining area would be approximately 4 feet in depth. Here's an elevation showing that it would be bordered by a wrought iron type fence, and it would require it to be 6 inches raised from the sidewalk in order for it to be level with the interior floor area so that we'd have compatibility with ADA access. The area would be accessed by accordion doors that would be able to be opened, and they'd be fully sound attenuated, which we feel this is an improvement to the existing condition on the basis that the existing wall is a wooden framed building and the existing windows are not sound attenuated. As I mentioned, the bike corrals or the bike racks are proposed to be relocated pending council direction. And what's being considered are bike corrals. This is a new type of design that would be the first of the city would do. But basically, there are corrals that would be located in the public right-of-way. And the location that we're considering would be along Marine Avenue, adjacent to the existing crosswalks. So it's included a street view of potential areas here where the bike corrals could be located along the area shown in red, so that there's potential they would not have to impact any existing parking. The area of the bike racks, we do hope that we would be able to generate more than 20 spaces so that it would be more than replace the bike racks that are at Village Inn. And the applicant has been conditioned to contribute $12,000 towards the installation and maintenance of those racks. One important point is that we have conditioned the project that the bike racks or bike corrals shall be installed prior to issuance of building permits for the outdoor dining. We feel this is critical on the basis that we don't want to have a situation where we don't have any racks available in the Balboa Island at all. We do anticipate, talking with Public Works, that we potentially can get the bike corrals installed within 4 months, but be it that this is the first time the city has had a project like this, we aren't able to commit to any particular time frame. Therefore, we feel that it is important to ensure that this project is conditioned to maintain the current bike racks until the new bike racks are installed. And lastly, there is another condition related to the bike racks, and that is the council's direction. The project has been conditioned to require that the council provide direction to staff to pursue the bike corral option. So if we don't have the new bike corral locations, then that would put this use permit at jeopardy. Just want to give you a little more background. There are current permits in place. There's a use permit that was approved in 2009 that limits the use to no dancing. The restaurant is required to close at midnight, and doors on Park Avenue close at 8 p.m. In 2012, there's live entertainment issued that allows five musicians, and provided that the doors are closed when that live entertainment is offered, and specific standards related to noise. We also obviously have our noise ordinance that requires maintenance of certain noise levels, both at residential uses and the existing use. There have been comments related to noise. As I want to point out here, the comments we received are calls for service since 2012 have varied significantly. This year to date, we've had 3 calls for service. However, we have not identified any violations to the code as a result of those calls. On top of that, we have random code enforcement that visits the Village Inn and has not identified any purposes for noticing violations. As listed in the bottom there, in 2015, there was one notice of violation issued, and that was related to the encroachment that, again, has been resolved through the abatement process. So we've identified some of the critical conditions of approval. One are the hours of operation. The first one is Council Policy L21, and that is basically indicating that City Council, their role is to ensure that the location of this outdoor dining in the public right-of-way is subject to their review. L21 will be their requirement for them to waive certain elements, such as the raising of the platform and surrounding the patio with the guardrail. Also, as I mentioned, City Council approval is required for the relocation and installation of the bike racks. Another piece related to the operation is that the glass doors would be noise attenuated, as well as all other windows, as well as the installation of acoustic panels. And also, the applicant has indicated the ability to reduce the number of musicians to 4 from 5. And lastly, there will be an operator's license required as a result of this use permit. As you know, this is a great piece for the city to have, in that it allows the police department to have greater level of review and control of operators, in that if we do see any type of violations, the police department has the ability to regulate those. So with that, we do recommend approval for the use permit to establish the outdoor dining. The first is the fact that the project does satisfy the findings for the use permit. We feel that the noise analysis demonstrates it does comply with the requirements of compatibility for the neighborhood, and those findings can be made. Secondly, that the noise analysis does identify the specific noise attenuation measures that would improve upon the current operations, not only the acoustical panels, but the windows being double paned, and also the outdoor dining area would install the additional attenuated windows. And letter C is identifying the fact that this is assist in implementing policy 5.3.4. And what that is, it identifies the fact that outdoor dining really is encouraged in this type of environment, in that an outdoor dining activates the sidewalks and the public space by drawing upon the activity from the business onto the street itself, adding to the vibrancy of this neighborhood. So that is the purpose of L21 and why the City Council recognized the benefits of outdoor dining, and that is why this policy is in place. So with that, I'm available for questions. The applicant is here, as well as the noise consultant, and I'm also joined by representatives from the police department and our code enforcement. Thank you.
Thank you, Brenda. Any commission questions for staff? Commissioner Lawler.
Brenda, just to clarify, so that the 4 months of the bike rack, if it doesn't happen in 4 months, could you repeat what exactly happens with the applicant's application and the city's obligation to do that? I just want to make sure I understand that.
As the condition is currently written, the building permit should not be issued until the new bike corrals are installed. We have not tied the condition to a specific time frame. Public Works has indicated they anticipate it to take no more than 4 months. However, we are not comfortable indicating a specific time frame within the condition, because if we do that, we will be the chance of those bike racks being removed without the new ones being in place.
So the city is not, or the staff's not supportive of Ms. McDermott's letter and her suggested amendment to that one conditions of approval? Is that
That's correct?
Correct. Okay, thanks.
Is there a designation in the city that defines if something's like a restaurant or a bar?
Yes, there is. It basically falls back on the type of license. This being a type 47 indicates it is a restaurant with a bona fide eating establishment.
So this right now it's designated as a restaurant based
That's
on
correct.
The license. Okay. And then if, by right, if they were going to do renovation to their to the Village Inn and they wanted to not put seating out in the right-of-way, but do some doors that opened up or windows that opened up just to have an indoor-outdoor feel for the dining experience, could they do that by right and not get a discretionary action from a commission or the zoning administrator?
Yes, they could. The use permit is triggered only by a change in operation. So they could come in and put in a large paned window that could open just with the building permit.
Okay. That's all I have for now.
Anyone else? I have a couple questions. So Wendy, with respect to these police calls, looks like there's kind of been a haphazard number over the last few years. But the data from staff is that there's been no violations. So can you kind of walk through, what's happened here? I mean, who's calling, what's going on? What's the kind of, I'd like some more information for the record.
In 2016, I actually only have with my data tonight 2 calls for service. I don't know who's calling on those specifically. In 2015, forgive me, the 2016 calls, both of them were unfounded. Not to say that it didn't occur, it's just that it was quiet by the time we got there. In 2015, we had 4 excessive noise complaints. and three nights, all were anonymous. Two were confirmed. The police did experience excessive noise when they got there. We also did, in 2015, 8 additional self-initiated visits from patrol. And one of those times, the officer thought the noise was excessive.
So once the officer, the police officer, makes that determination that the noise was excessive, what then occurred?
You told them to quiet down, and they do.
Okay. So there wasn't an official notice of violation then?
No, there's never been an official notice of violation from the PD.
Okay. Is this typical of how these things work in the city when there's issues of potential noise violation?
It's typical when we experience a good working relationship with a location, of which we do with the Village Inn. They've never been, well, in recent years, they've never been a problem location for us. I find no evidence that they have an over-service problem. For example, I pulled in the last calendar, well, the last 12 months, I pulled every drunken public contact that we had, and we couldn't find evidence that one of them on the island had come from the Village Inn. In fact, most of them come from homes in the area. So we experienced, like I said, a good working relationship, so there's never been a need for a violation.
Okay. And Brenda, can you introduce the code enforcement officer?
This is your senior code enforcement officer, Cassie Palmer.
Hi, Cassie. So I assume you're here to provide some additional testimony. So the question that I have is, it seems to me that there's been a fair amount of communication from various residents of code enforcement issues, or their perceived lack of code, enforcing of those codes. So can you provide some additional color for that, on that?
Thank you. We also receive complaints regarding noise. We do spot checks about once a month. We've also found that during those spot checks, those aren't responses to complaints like how police department is, but during those times, we've never found a noise violation. As part of their live entertainment permit, there are specific requirements that control the noise when, as it relates to the instruments and the bands there. We've always found that they've been in compliance. So we go out, the officers are equipped with sound meters, we do readings, things of that nature. There has yet to be any notice of violation issued for a violation of that noise ordinance.
Okay. So when there's a perceived violation that's occurring in a resident or whomever calls, do they call the police or do they call you? Or do they call both? Trying to figure out how this works.
Yeah, they call both.
Okay.
So typically what happens if we receive a complaint, then we'll rely on the police department because it's after hours. If we're getting an influx of complaints, like similar to the 2015, code enforcement may receive several complaints, so we'll notify the police department. You know, when you're out on patrol, can you, you know, take a look to make sure, you know, things are in order? If there are any follow-ups to be done, we follow up with the police department, and then we would go back the following day to have discussions. Typically, when we've received those complaints from the residents, we pass that along to the police department, and again, there's no violations found. When code enforcement responds, that's a little bit more proactive because it's not, you know, directly at that moment when they're calling. They may have called 2 days prior, so we schedule an appointment, you know, and go out. It's that weekend. So when we go out, then again, we do those monitoring, and there hasn't been any complaints. The only other complaints that we receive from the residents relate to kind of property maintenance and things of that nature, and we still also haven't found that they've been in violation of property maintenance standards or anything that would warrant a notice of violation.
Okay, thank you. Attorney Torres, has the city had any correspondence, legal in nature, from any residents with respect to this this application or with respect to ongoing operations of the applicant?
Chairman Kramer, with this application, and I think with the last public hearing as well, there have been a number of letters submitted by
local residents, both in support and in opposition to this application. But in terms of any legal issues, I think we received a letter a couple days ago from an attorney representing some of the local residents in opposition. We reviewed that today with Community Development Director Brandt and Deputy Director Wisniewski, and we don't think that letter raised any issues that cause us any concerns from a legal perspective from moving forward with the application tonight.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Okay, report of ex parte communications. I met with the applicant on site and have had several communications with the applicant's consultant. Commissioner Zach.
I've had several conversations with the applicant's consultant. I've gone out on site several times, and I've spoken on the phone with a couple of the residents who live near the Village Inn.
I've spoken with the applicant's consultant.
I've met with the applicant's consultant on site and had a telephonic conversation.
And I, too, did a site visit and met with the applicant's consultant.
Okay, thank you. Let's open the public hearing. Does the applicant have a presentation?
Good evening, Chairman and members of the Commission. My name is Dan Miller. It's been over 4 years since I began operating the Village Inn with a dream of reestablishing this Newport Beach icon. A location that Orange County has put Orange County on the map as a destination for enjoyment, esprit de corps, and community. The Village Inn is a center point, a link between the traditional and modern impacts of Balboa Island and Newport Beach, a place where generations of families, military, teachers, artists, entrepreneurs, entertainers have always gathered to represent the community. Our team has prepared a very thorough, well-thought, well-considered, and highly inclusive picture of our intentions with outdoor dining, including the limitations we have agreed to in recognition of our neighbors' comments. We have heard the complaints about noise and responded by obtaining professional acoustic data and creating solutions that will positively impact the interior and exterior noise, although we currently operate within our established conditions. We have heard the concerns about bike rack locations and have worked diligently with the city to provide solutions that not only improve the perceived impression of our neighbors, but also elevate the purpose and value that bike racks offer our fellow merchants. We have found through survey, what we have found through survey is that approximately 20% of bike rack users actually enter into the Village Inn, leading us to believe that the entire merchant community and biking community will benefit from this adjustment. Our business model is shifting to one that facilitates more daytime dining. The changes that are occurring are a benefit to all, including the approximate 97% who support, despite what we estimate to be about 3% who oppose the outdoor dining upgrade. We are taking the Village Inn in the right direction, and in order to thrive, we need the opportunity to align with what locals enjoy and tourists seek. In case my character is questioned, as it was the last time I was here with you, by a well-spoken yet limited number of neighbors who may challenge my family-owned and operated business, I wish to offer the following. I have operated established restaurants for 11 years. I'm a third-year PhD student. I've served our country training thousands of military personnel overseas. I've spent countless hours building strong relationships on Balboa Island and in Newport Beach while sustaining the integrity of a business structure that develops people. We are traditional and modern, a clear parallel to the conservative yet outgoing nature of Newport Beach. While we put the Village Inn under the microscope today, I believe it is important to understand that the VI has been standing on Balboa Island for over 83 years. The Village Inn is a part of the infrastructure of this community, and in fact, its sheer presence has created value on the island in both property values and community values. The Village Inn I took over was a bar. The Village Inn you walk into today is a restaurant with cocktail service, complete with a dynamic warmth, substance, and feeling of inclusiveness that gives the locals a place to meet and entertain their friends. We have built a team that is proud to represent this community with great food and great service. The approval we are seeking today is undertaken as responsible owners. In fact, it is in direct correlation to the request and defining needs of the community. Outdoor seating is a staple of elegant coastal dining. It values a clientele that seeks to embrace the rewards of living and experiencing what we have been so blessed to call our community. We support the staff recommendations, findings, and conditions of approval. We urge your affirmative vote to allow the Village Inn to enhance its offerings with outdoor dining. And now allow me to introduce Carol McDermott, who will present our brief PowerPoint presentation on the details of the proposal.
Mr. Chairman, members of the Commission, I believe it's loaded and ready to go, and I will try to go through as quickly as possible. I do need to emphasize a number of the points that the staff has made, and I didn't mean to duplicate, and you did a great presentation, but I didn't know you were doing all that, so I'll try to move through quickly. But there's a great history of this property, and we all know where it's located. She's already showed you that. And the history of this site, I think, is an important part of what we're talking about today. It's over 80 years old, and it has evolved in a variety of ways, and I'll describe that in just a second. But it was originally called Hershey's Cafe, and it's Hershey's Market is kitty corner across the street, built in 32. Originally even had outdoor seating. And then there was a plant nursery adjacent to the cafe on what is now the residential site, and it has evolved. And in 1956, it became the Village Inn, and in 2002, the permit was issued for live entertainment. And here's Dan Miller and his lovely wife, and he serves on the board of the BIIA and the Merchants Association, and they specifically asked him to participate because of his character and his integrity. And he's enhanced the restaurant, he's improved the menu, as he indicated, and he's working to add to the island ambiance in a mixed-use zone. This fade is an interesting. Does it always fade, or can it click? Okay,
it
well,
just fades for you.
we're gonna work it as quick as it can. But we all like the island experience of Balboa, and a lot of us go there for a variety of exercise and dining experiences, and just to kind of hang out on the island. It's vibrant. It's holds a lot of history for a lot of families. And outdoor parties are frequently a part of the island residencies. And BIIA and the Merchants Association hosts events on the 100 block, and including the parade and the 100-year anniversary. And they sponsor parties on our property because we're community-oriented, and we allow that to happen in ways that have continued the historical interest in hosting Santa and refreshments during the annual Christmas boat parade. And in March 2009, they already indicated that approval was given to the restaurant and bar for minor remodeling. They increased the food sales, and it's trending upward. And they've increased, as Dan said, from bar food to fine dining. And if you haven't had their bone-in ribeye, you haven't lived. Under project objectives, I always think it's important to explain what the owner and the operators want to accomplish. And we want to enhance the island experience, and we want to attenuate noise more effectively and to further the fine dining experience by al fresco and continue to provide the community gathering place. The Merchants Association meets in the back room, and the Balboa Island Improvement Association has their meetings there as well. And often there will be class reunions and others that have gone to appreciate the friendly nature. And we want to always remain consistent with our ABC license and the entertainment permit, and finally to commit to additional conditions of approval. And I can't emphasize that enough. I've got a better pointer that I want to use. And so what does our outdoor dining plan look like? It is basically 16 seats where the existing bike racks are. And the bike racks have become quite an annoyance to the neighborhood. And as a result, we worked very hard since our continuance a month ago in order to find a good solution for bike racks and bike corrals. We researched the internet. We contacted the city of Portland and Seattle, who are very bike friendly. We looked at their solutions. We looked at what the costs were. We looked at what it would take to install new bike racks and what the locations would be. And as the staff indicated, we are consistent with city planning documents, and I won't go all along that, but the general plan recommends outdoor seating, and your city council has approved a number of locations for outdoor dining within the public right-of-way, and they have waived the L21 requirements because of this particular general plan policy. And there are outdoor dining near residential uses in a few places, and I believe that soon we're going to see more of that. So what are the elements? We want to replace the old windows, which are not sound attenuated, and they will be full height, and they'll be double paned. And we're also proposing a plexiglass barrier around the southern edge of the outdoor dining in this area, which will create an additional noise barrier for the noise coming in these directions. And we would retain the sidewalk at a minimum 6 foot wide, and the L21 policy allows that flexibility for the council to consider that and to authorize the bike corrals. And the building elevation here shows that with the addition of the new windows, we will have a vastly improved appearance of the front of the old 80-year-old restaurant. And the wrought iron fencing along the edge will add a finish. Of course, it's required for safety and for ABC license requirements, but it will provide some continuity for the exterior. And at the corner, we have to provide new ADA access, which allows for a revised radius and will allow for an enhancement of the existing landscaping in that location, so that it will be a much softer appearance. And this is a really good picture of the existing bike racks, and what we found in the use of that is that only 19% of the users were our patrons, and in fact, most of them were shoppers in the merchant area. And so in finding out where we might relocate them, we found some good locations in the 200 and 300 block. Moving that element of concern from the neighbors to the area where merchants can benefit from them. So in this aerial, we have identified four locations of possible bike rack locations. And this is the style of the bike corral. And we can accommodate in those spaces, according to the dimensions provided by the manufacturer, up to 44 bikes. And that $12,000 fee will go a long way towards more than replacing what is being removed. And another picture close-up of where these red spaces, these red areas have been preserved, and it would still allow for good visibility, but put the bike racks where they're going to get maximum usage. And in this case, right in front of where Abrams is, and it's at the crosswalks. So there's a natural location and good usage. And these bike corral were unanimously and affirmatively supported by the Merchants Association, and they were very glad to see us creating the impetus for this to finally occur. So then the other issue that we know has been of concern is noise of a restaurant and the nighttime entertainment. So the noise study was concluded and submitted, and the noise measurements were taken so that they could evaluate what the noise contours would be. And as you have seen in other noise reports, noise moves in contours, and it comes outward in not a direct shot. And so the 65 CNL, prior to entertainment, before the entertainment started, the 65 CNL was here. And the other noise levels came out to here, which were in the 45 and 50 range. So they were not in violation of any of the noise codes. And then the future noise environment, when we upgrade the sound attenuating windows and seals, reduces those noise contours even further, again, in lowering even below what the city's noise ordinance requires. So then we were asked to consider what is the noise of the outdoor dining. So a subsequent study was prepared, and we evaluated the noise levels. And again, these contours show that with the outdoor dining that we're out to here with 50, and the noise levels extending down to the adjacent residences are way below what happens on the street. So what are those key findings? In that updated noise study, we found that the ambient noise level, meaning that which just happens on a daily basis, is localized vehicle traffic. It's noise from pedestrians walking within the neighborhood. And frankly, there's aircraft overflight that we all live with. But the existing ambient noise levels were documented to be higher than the noise ordinance daytime threshold. So what the city's goal is for daytime thresholds was actually exceeded by things that you can't control and that were not part of our restaurant. So our conclusion was in the modeling of the noise study, and we can't measure it until we have actual outdoor dining, but in the modeling, with the doors open and with outdoor dining for 16 patrons, noise levels from interior and exterior patrons will be below the 55 dBA noise limit and below the existing ambient noise levels. So that means that the existing levels on the street are probably going to be greater than what will be happening with people eating and talking. And again, that's with no entertainment, of course, during the day. So we have a lot of noise attenuation. The staff has mentioned that. I will go through it quickly. But some key things: we're going to upgrade the windows. We're going to completely close the doors with seals prior to any entertainment. If outdoor dining patrons are there when it's time to start the entertainment, the operator has the flexibility of telling the entertainer to wait until we can get the diners indoors. And that's a condition, and it's a commitment. And no televisions, amplified sound, or paging systems allowed in the outdoor seating area. It's a little understood because there's not room for it, but we just wanted to emphasize that it wouldn't and couldn't be permitted. And then the 5-foot plexiglass material that would be placed at the southerly end, we felt was in direct response to issues raised by the nearby residents. So with the noise attenuation, it will be approximately 45 dBA at the property line of 123 Marine during the nighttime. That's the property line adjacent to our closest neighbor. And it's below the noise ordinance requirements, and it's in compliance with our entertainment permit. So once again, we will not exceed the city's noise standards. And we've modified our entertainment style since the residents have asked us to. So we've fired some noisy bands that the audiences loved, but we got rid of them to try to be more responsive. We've contracted entertainers now that are only groups of one or two or three, and we're now willing to limit those entertainers to a maximum of four, and frequently there's just a single vocalist with a guitar that is entertaining. So then there's also the question of noise and vibration. So in an attempt to address that, we've installed new noise attenuated window facing 123 Marine. We've applied noise attenuating paint inside. We've installed acoustical panels. This is all before we've even come to you to ask for an approval. And we have curtains that we pull when the entertainment starts. We removed the window controls from the old windows so that that patrons couldn't open the windows. The one night there was a valid complaint, the window was erroneously left open or forced open, and management did their best to get it closed and to make sure that residents, patrons knew that they could not be opened. And then we put a circular noise barrier around the rooftop blower. And I think as the code enforcement officer testified at the last hearing and confirmed really tonight, is that complaints have been made relative to the bass sounds, but they have not violated the city's noise ordinance. And that's what we're required to comply with and they're required to enforce. Occasionally you hear bass sounds coming from an automobile because someone has it so loud, but we have really not been in violation of that requirement. So I summarized the things that we've done since March 2016, and we're agreeing to fewer musicians. And the other thing that was mentioned in regards to noise was the truck deliveries that may be happening very early behind the restaurant. And the owner-operator confirmed with me that he and Wilma's operator, had a joint delivery that was being made very early in the morning because it was easier for the truck to get on the island. But they are willing now to agree to a condition that they would not have any truck deliveries earlier than 6 a.m. nor past 9 p.m. And I just want to indicate that we really have widespread support for this project and lots of loyal participants and unanimous support from the Merchants Association. And I think you can see the cards behind me indicating the support that we have. And also, I wanted to show you the mapping that we did of these supporters on Balboa Island based on signatures that were gathered at the restaurant and with people interested in what we were going to be proposing. So the green dots are specifically tied to addresses from petitions that have been signed. And so I would conclude by just respectfully requesting your approval with all of the conditions. And the one thing that I did want to mention is that it has to do with the timing of the installation of the bike corrals. And because we're providing the impetus to the city to really institute the first corrals in the city and to provide good bike parking solutions and to be able to move these bikes away from the existing residences on Marine Avenue, I have some additional language that I believe was distributed to you, and it is asking that we'll submit the money, but within the 30 days of the effective date of the City Council action, because I think it's only fair that we would not have to submit those fees until we knew we had an approval, and that also the bike corrals would be installed prior to issuance of building permits. We understand and agree with that, but we do believe that it would be reasonable to ask the city to try to get that done within 120 days or 4 months of the effective date of the City Council action, because I know they've been looking at it since we first started talking about it, so it's not a new subject. They've been doing research and some consideration, and we would respectfully ask that there be an opportunity for us to know that we would not be unduly delayed with that condition of approval. So we'd respectfully ask that you consider that. And both the owner and the operator and our team is available for any questions if I can be of any additional assistance to you.
Thank you. Any commission questions for the applicant? Algren.
Thank you. Carol, you know landscape is my challenge, and you said there's enhanced landscaping. I haven't seen any plans that reflect that. Could you share with us what you're thinking about?
Well, we didn't prepare the plans because that's usually a condition subsequent for a small planter area like this, but we'd be glad to submit them and make sure that the staff approves them, or if you want them brought back to the commission, we can do that as well.
I don't think they need to be brought back to the commission, but I view that this, the end of the street is an important look, and how this ends up appearing is important, and I'm just curious as to where it might go. I think the patio is thin as it relates to landscaping, so I'm just curious as to what you're contemplating, because this is the first I've heard.
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear the last part of your question.
This is the first I've heard, so I'm just curious as to where this enhanced landscaping would go.
Well, if we can go back, I don't know how to quite get this back quick enough, but in this area here, right at the corner. So it's, here's the main entrance, here's the secondary entrance. So there's small planters in these two locations. These are benches. And then this would be the area of enhanced landscaping right at the corner, which is what I think you're referring to, the need to create some enhancement. And so there's a vertical element on the building there. And right now there's a there's one tall plant with some ground cover, and we would be enhancing the vertical element of that landscaping as well as enhanced ground cover.
Anything at, where the plant or where the seating area is?
I'm sorry?
Is there any landscaping, any pots, anything where the seating area is, the new
outdoor
seating
area? Well,
there
isn't any room because we only have the 4 feet.
Okay, thank you.
Any other commission questions? Commissioner Zach.
I have a few questions, Ms. McDermott. First of all, I don't know if staff can pull up the elevation that shows the patio and the all the doors.
What is it you want to see? I wasn't following.
I think Brennan knows what I want to see. There you go, that one, the proposed building elevation. So, and that just went away. I've walked around, you know, around the city and looked at a number of, like, outdoor patio dining experiences throughout the city. And I just, you know, one of the things that I'm struggling with is you've got, most of those are just accessed by one door. Like, and I'm not understanding why you need so many doors to open up, and just, it's basically you're opening up this whole wall. Can you shed some light on that?
Sure.
For me?
In fact, I have looked at the doors on the other recent approvals for outdoor dining, and ours is significantly different, and it's because we only have 4 feet in that area to put the tables and chairs, and so we actually have to serve from inside the restaurant to the tables. So if we don't have room to just have one door, because if we had one door, then we couldn't go around and serve those tables. So we do need those doors. But the good news is that they're going to give a new finished look to the exterior, and they're noise attenuated in a way that neither the wall nor the existing windows are. So yeah. Ultimately, I think it's going to be a vastly improved situation.
Okay, I got that. That makes sense to me. I couldn't get my head around why you needed so many doors open. So maybe just kind of start, take me back, because this came before us several months ago, and I it was, the commission voted against this, and I'm just trying to understand, why is this so important to the owner and operator of the Village Inn? Is it to change a perception? Is it to create a better dining experience? I never really kind of quite understand why this is such a big deal.
Well, it certainly is a big deal, or we wouldn't have spent all this time and money
to
get here.
Yeah.
But what I wanted to say was that right now the building does not appear, as visitors are coming down Marine Avenue, to be a restaurant. It's not visible. It's not apparent. And in addition, when you're on the island, the idea of being outdoors is very desirable. And so while it's been a very interior, and it was for a long time a bar, and therefore it was totally enclosed, now that dining is being enhanced, they want to add that outdoor experience. In addition, the outdoor seating is going to help them continue to increase the amount of food service and reduce the bar service. And so it's an important element to that part of their business plan.
Okay. This is probably more technical question. Condition number 17, it talks about the installation of these interior acoustical panels.
Yes.
Are those just along this wall in the area where the doors are, or is it around the whole building?
It's around the whole building.
Okay.
And they're up at the top, which is you need the noise attenuation.
And then is your the consultant that you hired to do the acoustical study, are they here?
Or I can't hear you, I'm sorry.
The consultant that you hired to do the acoustical study, are they present here?
Unfortunately, he could not be here. He did submit the revised report with the update regarding the outdoor dining figures. I'm sorry he couldn't be here. We will try to answer anything as best we can.
Well, my question is, I just... trying to understand how they measure noise for people talking out on the patio, because people have different tones and different noise levels of their voice. I might speak more softly than Chair Kramer, and so.
But in spite of the fact that I can't hear you,
that's right. So I'm just trying to kind of better understand, and maybe that's too technical of a question, but maybe you asked the consultant that same question.
Well, actually, we did, and it's like many situations. Like sometimes with traffic, you've got to model it, and those models are based on very standard procedures that are contained in noise manuals and that are typically adopted, whether it's through the Urban Land Institute or the American Planning Association or the National Association of Acoustical Engineers. But they use those standards in modeling. But granted, it's a model.
Right.
So if we need to...
So it's a model, and it's computer-generated, and if we open up the doors and the model wasn't right, we got a problem.
Well, we don't think that's going to be the case, but certainly if that were...
We don't have any, like, actual empirical data, because we can't test it until we open it up and see how it ends up being.
Well, is there a way that we could work in the future to sort of prove that and or be required to have additional noise attenuation or different conditions of approval?
We can maybe address that later. Let's kind of let others ask questions.
We've done the best we can at this point. Thank you.
Any other questions for the applicant? Commissioner Lawler.
Maybe just a comment to that you know, we as commissioners, our job wouldn't be to speculate on the noise. We can only deal with the facts at hand. So I know we all know that. I'm just saying more on the public behalf. You know, our job is to look at the noise study, see if it's factual or not, and not speculate what may happen. So I know you know that, Commissioner Zach.
Absolutely. But we've got residents that are living right adjacent or across the street, and intuitively you're opening up this whole wall. And if the model's wrong, I mean, there's an impact there, and you can't make some of the findings. So, I get some ideas possibly how to address it later, but I your point's well taken.
Okay, let me just remind everyone tonight that the only matter before us tonight on this application is the amendment to the conditional use permit to allow a 200 square foot outdoor dining area in the front of the restaurant within the public right-of-way. It's not about, you know, code enforcement or those other items that we had some data added to the record, so appreciate that. But the issue for the Planning Commission, our jurisdiction, is land use, not code enforcement. So with that, I'll open up the general public comments. So please come forward if you'd like to comment. 3-minute limitation. Please fill out the speaker card.
Hi, everybody. My name is Michelle Kasten, and as a 25-year resident of Newport Beach, specifically Irvine Terrace, and someone who is on Balboa Island several times a week shopping and eating, I would like to express my support tonight for outdoor dining during limited hours at the Village Inn. As you know, in beautiful Corona del Mar, the Village, it's become even more attractive now that restaurants along PCH have been allowed to put tables outside, creating small patio spaces to dine under the stars. The wide sidewalk at the end of Marine Avenue can accommodate a few dining tables to enhance the experience at the Village Inn, and this is a place that I would love to enjoy. I enjoy it now, but I'd love it even more, and I know that friends and island visitors would as well. I did a little bit of quick research today and found out that when live music plays, as you heard at the Village Inn, the doors and windows of this outdoor area will be closed. Very reasonable, I believe, for the residents nearby. And I also called Hershey's Market, catty corner to the Village Inn. The closing hours there are 9, 10, or 11 p.m., as you know, depending on the season and the day of the week. So there's foot traffic and conversation going on there, much like there would be at the dining tables outdoors. I wanted to show you this historical photo of the Village Inn dating back to the 30s and 40s, and you can see, or maybe you can't, but if you take a look later, there was outdoor dining back then. The business, of course, had just a few homes around it, and I bring this up because I spoke before the city council a month or so ago. We had a big issue at CDM, the high school. I have a daughter there, and the council was initially proposing a ban on parking on the ring road there. The residents of East Bluff had an issue with it. And I brought up an old photo and showed that CDM was there by itself. There were no homes in East Bluff. We talked to the council about the desire to compromise between the needs of students and East Bluff neighbors, and we're happy to say we compromised. When the school was built, there were no homes around it. Likewise, when the Village Inn opened, there were just a few cottages nearby. More homes, of course, have gone up near the Village Inn. And those residents, of course, have requests. And so like CDM, with the issue there, I know that there are ways to compromise and accommodate the needs of both in this situation. And it appears that changes to the doors and windows at the Village Inn will make it even quieter. A few outdoor tables here seem perfectly reasonable, with restrictions, of course. It's something that I support, and I believe that many people behind me here support it as well. Thank you so much.
Good evening. My name is Michael Lawler, a longtime resident of Balboa Island. My wife, Barbara, and I, we live on 120 Coral Avenue. I've also worked on Balboa Island as an attorney for many, many years, and grew up on the island as a kid, so I know the island really well, and very much enjoy going to the Village Inn, and my wife and I are very much looking forward to doing some outdoor dining here. I've read the staff report. I got to commend the staff for doing a fabulous job in working up the resolution and the conditions of approval. I'm pleased to see that Dan Miller's accepting all of those conditions. I think they're really very well thought out. And you know, at first I wasn't really sure about this because I saw some neighbor signs saying stop the Village Inn expansion. I was like, what's this fuss all about? So I took the time to meet with Dan Miller and learned about this project, and I got to say that the more I learn about it, the more I like it, and I strongly support it and urge your approval tonight. Thank you very much.
Callahan, Balboa Island. The Village Inn is an institution on Balboa Island, has been for 83 years. I've seen many owners of the VI, the Hersheys, the Yardley Brothers, Peter Chin, the Toll family, Lance Wagner, and now Dan and Jessica Miller. They're the best of the owners. I've seen a lot of them. They care about Balboa Island and Newport Beach. Outdoor dining is a way of life around the world. It's in the culture in many cities. I know I've had cocktails in a lot of those cities. Dan and Jessica plan to open up for limited outside dining. It's a great idea. It fits the Balboa Island lifestyle. Dan and Jessica are trying to do their best to improve the Village Inn, hiring architects and sound engineers. You've heard all that, to upgrade the building. The Millers are good operators. I have absolutely no reservations about their plans to enhance the dining experience at the VI. I support the Millers, their staff, and the integrity of the project. And I think the additional bike racks are a good idea also. And if you go back to the police records of many years ago, go back to the 60s, 70s, and 80s, even the 50s, you'll see there were a lot more police calls at the VI than there ever been today. Thank you very much.
Good evening. I'm the first person to speak tonight that lives anywhere near the Village Inn. My name is Peter Bergman. I live at 120 Marine across the street and two doors down. I'm here with my neighbors, as I was back in December when you last heard this appeal for outdoor dining. Back then, we could not believe that after 3 years of constant noise problems where neighbors with their doors and windows closed could literally hear lyrics from songs from the Village Inn in their living rooms, where Saturdays and Sundays sports games with windows open, we could hear loud cheering and across the street. With all of that, the city was considering opening an entire wall of windows. You're right, Mr. Zach. Probably 35 feet of windows, 8 feet tall, an entire wall open from 7 a.m. till 10 p.m. to let more noise onto our residential block. We couldn't believe then that they were proposing a public bike rack in the middle of a residential lawn next door. Tonight, we can't believe that 11 months later, 11 months of working with planning staff and public works, they have no other answer for the bikes, just a promise to find one. That December night, by a 4-2 vote, this commission said no to outdoor dining on its own merits. And tonight, we can't believe we're all back here again listening to the same proposal. We don't wish the Village Inn any harm. We want them to thrive, but we can't believe they're still being called a restaurant. It is not a restaurant with alcohol. It is a bar. Thank you. It is a bar that serves food. It is a saloon during the day. It is a sports bar in the evening and on weekend afternoons. It is a nightclub with live music at night, a place with music so loud and raucous that signs inside say no dancing. When was the last time all of you went out with your spouses to a restaurant where you had to worry about people getting up from their tables and dancing? Well, it happens all the time at the Village Inn, apparently. We can't believe we're back here again.
Excuse me. Please, please, maintain order. We don't need the cat calls and boos. Please show respect. We all live in the same community.
We can't believe we're back here again. But we will be here each and every time this comes up because this is where we live. We're protecting the value of our homes. And because this makes no more sense than it did a year ago, I'm asking you to please vote no again. Thank you very much for your time.
Good evening. I'm nervous again. My name is Tina Sullivan, and I live at 121 Marine Avenue with my husband, Mike, who has lived there for 38 years. Long before I met my husband, he served our city as a street cop and a police detective. He knows a lot about what we're talking about here tonight. Disturbing the peace, by the way, is a crime. Multiple and repeated violations of a restaurant's use permit and the city's municipal codes should disqualify an establishment from seeking a better use permit and special privileges like outdoor dining. My husband can tell you he's seen five owners of the Village Inn, but there has never been anything like what these owners have done to our neighborhood. From the very beginning, they have violated every rule of common decency toward their neighbors. Not even when everyone on our street signed a petition begging them to give us a break with their loud band music did anything change. My family still hears nightclub band music in our house. This establishment has violated sections 16, 17, 18, 22, and 23 of their use permit, any one of which authorizes the city manager to revoke their entertainment permit. They also have and are continuing to violate sections 3, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 11 of their entertainment permit, and they routinely violate Municipal Code 5.28.040, Section B3, the most serious of those listed. You have seen photos and video recordings verifying these violations. Last year, we all stood here before you with the same noise complaints about this same establishment and their same pursuit of outdoor dining privileges. You voted for 4-2 against that expansion. I hope you will still remember what they did to our neighborhood to deserve that vote. This time around, they're asking for even more. These are the same people, and they haven't changed their ways. Remember, the big bike rack next to the Village Inn is owned by the city, as is the sidewalk under it. The Village Inn wants the city to give them that sidewalk so they can expand outward, leaving only the minimum legal sidewalk space for pedestrians, 4 feet narrower than the sidewalk in front of all other businesses on Marine Avenue. This scheme has all the markings of a sweetheart deal that just doesn't pass the smell test. Our entire block is unanimously against this expansion. It's just too close to people's houses. The Village Inn is at the end of a residential block, not in the middle of a commercial district. If you do this to us, we would never recover. We would never be able to sell our house. We wouldn't even be able to rent it. My children would be stuck here right next to that noise. Please don't do this to us. Thank you.
Good evening, Council. I'm a resident of Newport Beach, also an attorney here in Newport Beach. And to me, that restaurant is not just a bar. It is actually a restaurant. I have a 9-year-old boy, 7-year-old girl, and we take them there all the time, at night, not during the day. It is a very family-friendly place. I believe that the people that are against this are embellishing this. Speculation that they can't sell their house, speculation that, of the noise. It's just not true. The studies are there. The people that have gone, code enforcement, stand outside, listen. That's real life. They're just concerned. I wish you could give them more space. I think outdoor seating is a great idea. My mom comes down every December, and one thing she wants to do, go to the Village Inn and have dinner right before the boat parade, because she loves it. They've made it into a nice-looking place inside. It is now comforting. It's not a bar. I'm 50 years old. I've been there when I was in my 20s. It's nothing like the way it is now. It is a true family experience ran by a family. Dan and Jessica also have a kid. So they are a very family-oriented family. And so I'm telling you, this should be approved. It's going to help the city. It's going to help the island. And I trust you that if anything does go wrong, Daniel will be the first one to try to fix it without any problems. You can see what he's done so far to try to address any issue you guys have had. Thank you.
My name is Ellis Marcus, and I live at 122 Marine Avenue, and I have lived there for more than 40 years, across the street from where they plan to put outdoor dining. I'm a past president of the Balboa Island Improvement Association, and have been volunteering for the past 20 years to make our island a better place to live. The proposed project is not an improvement and will have a negative impact on nearby homes on Marine Avenue. This used to be a peaceful street before the new owners came. The house and yard directly across from me were beautiful and well kept. The restaurant was also quiet, and we had a great relationship with the owners as we had with all five previous owners. But all that changed when these new owners took over. The once beautiful yard was turned into a dumping ground for discarded and broken restaurant equipment, including large booths, broken tables, and even a broken rusted water heater, all dumped in the front yard. And it stayed there for 3 years until we complained to the city to come and clean it up. This is the very establishment for which these owners now want you to grant them special privilege. The outdoor dining is way too close to our houses. And as you can see, these owners are not the people you can trust to obey the rules and keep it clean and quiet. Outdoor dining by this very nature is noisy. And the very wide open doors they plan would aim the sports bar noise from inside right at our house like a megaphone. Outdoor dining is fine in the middle of a business district, but this is right on top of our homes. Most of my neighbors on Marine Avenue are retirees, and their source of income is from rentals in their duplexes. Their livelihood depends on making their rentals attractive places to live in. If our tenants are going to wake up to the sounds of dishes and silverware from 7 a.m. to 10 p.m., along with sports bar yelling, I believe we will have trouble keeping our rent tenants or getting new ones. And the lady mentioned, you know, that the BIA sponsored parties on that lot next door. Well, I was the president of the BIA. We didn't. These parties were sponsored by Eric, the previous owner, for the chair ladies that participated in the parade, and that was not the BIA function. Another thing I want to point out, you know, they say they want to remove the racks, bicycle racks, and put them on the streets. Now, when I was president, we made a survey of Marine Avenue with the help of the city to place benches in there that exist in there. And all those benches were the red zones where they're planning to put bikes. And I suggest before they make plans for those, you know, there to go and check, because all those zones, we occupied all the zones, and people paid $3,000 to have those benches. And we turned over the money in escrow to the city to maintain it. And so what I'm saying, you know, before you decide to remove the racks, you better go and check it in there and see if there's space for those racks.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.
I just want to address really quickly. Thank you, first of all,
for
the
time. Hold on, he's next.
Excuse me.
Go ahead. You're not going to talk long. Go ahead.
I'll be very quick. Okay, thank you, first of all. I just really quickly wanted to adjust talk about the bike racks, and I think you really need to think about that. If you're going to put the bike racks in the 200 and 300 block, you're going to take an awful lot of traffic and now have the bikes riding down Marine. I don't know if that's a really good idea right now. An awful lot of people on the island, I'm not on the streets involved, go down the alley, come up, park in front of there, and then walk down the street. So those people that are doing that, now you're going to send them in the 200 and 300 block. Also, those areas where I see you're looking to put are the red areas, which are in front of the crosswalks. Sounds like a good idea, but think about it. Are the drivers going down the street going to see the person getting their bike and figure, okay, I'm okay, or is that person going to be walking across the street and all of a sudden you've got less time to adjust to see is somebody coming? Right now you got a red area so that you got a buffer. You can see the person crossing the street as a car going by. So I think you really can't pass on this idea of the bike racks, and I think it deserves an awful lot of thought before you jump into where we're going to put the bike racks, because they're needed on the island, they're used, and you certainly need a lot more in 20 places. Thank you. Thank you for your time.
Good evening. I shall be brief. My name is Tommy Crossan. I have lived on Balboa Island since 1954. That makes me the oldest guy in the room. And my family, we just sold that house, and they are tearing it down. Anyhow, I've heard noise from the Village Inn. And when you live on Balboa Island, that's the way life is. It's got better and better. I was thrown out of the Village Inn, and I was told not to come back. That was a long time ago. I brought a chimpanzee on Halloween on a chain. They were very unhappy with that. So I had to stay out of there for a year. Anyhow, it behooves residents and guests of Balboa Island, visitors and residents, it behooves you to support the business community. Because if you didn't have the businesses there, you wouldn't have Balboa Island. You have to support them. And you have to remember that they pay big money to buy these restaurants or any business. This is not a fellow that came in and rented the building. He bought the property. He bought two parcels of property. His family did. So he's here for good. I would hate to see him leave because he wasn't successful and get a Hooters in here. That would be bad. So aside from nitpicking on whether the awnings are going to, the tables are going to be close together or the doors, He wants to be a good neighbor. That's why he's here. He's in business to be successful. Lighten up a little bit. Give him a break. Let him do his thing and let him show you how he can perform and make this place even more attractive and better, and everybody will enjoy it. Thank you so much.
Hi. I'm Tom O'Brien, 105 Marine Avenue, many years. And some of the other things have already been said here tonight, and I just want to clarify a couple of things. That when you look at the charter of Newport Beach, several of the sections, they actually look at a conditional use permit is to promote the public health, safety, welfare, implement the goals, policies of the general plan, by ensuring that conditional uses in residential neighborhoods, and I'd like to clarify that because this is a residential neighborhood, but not change the character of the neighborhoods as primarily residential communities. The very nature of this proposal for an outdoor dining seems to me to be in conflict. Second, in order to be in compliance with this section that I just talked about, 20.52.080, the project must be approved prior to the ensure that the issues are fully integrated and that their potential impacts from different activities are fully mitigated. Now, this mitigation was brought up over noise. An outdoor area that's never existed in our neighborhood, outdoor dining, is going to go into place. Now, they've done the studies, and I have exactly the same concern that you brought up, is that how is that measured? And if we're wrong, what is the mitigation? I think it's the most serious question on the table. Finally, we've been talking about the 200 and 300 block, the serious blocks of the commercial part of Marine Avenue. There are 7 sit-down restaurants. They've been referred to as having some outside dining, which equates to like one little table on the sidewalk. But I would tell you, first of all, that like Wilma's, they've got outside dining, but it's recessed in. That's been mentioned for as a possible solution for them. And also, I think the major issue is those 2 blocks of commercial property have 10-foot sidewalks. You put this structure on this street, this section of street on Marine Avenue, in front of the Village Inn, it's 6, and it's not only the 6, but it's got a almost like a wall right next to the curb. And that, when you combine with people standing, talking to people who are sitting for dining, talking to people who are going to have dogs tied to that rail, and you know they are, the ADA starts to kick in. So the proposed structure, I oppose it. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Yari Appelroth, and I've been a resident of Newport Beach for 41 years. I have been visiting Balboa Island pretty much since the day I moved here. I've always loved that island. It is absolutely gorgeous to walk around. But I do have to say, I think the biggest eyesore on the entire island are the bicycle racks. Okay? I would like to make a recommendation. If you want to put the bicycle rack somewhere, why don't you put them right next to Hershey's Market, right across from the restrooms at the fire station? That will hide them. You can't even see them when you're walking or driving down Marine Avenue. And also, I've noticed that there's 97% approval and 3% no. I understand the 3%. You live right there. I can relate to you very, very much. But you have to also admit that those bicycle racks are not nice. They don't look pretty from your front. But if you had a very, very nice outdoor patio out there with some dining, I think it would even enhance the view of the way that you look from your front of your house. Now, I understand also the concern you have of the noise, okay?
Sir, you have to address the commission.
Oh, I'm sorry. I apologize. Okay. Anyway, I think it would be absolutely a beautiful, beautiful add-on to Balboa Island and all of that entire street. And I can tell you that Dan Miller is absolutely a wonderful, wonderful person, and I think he will care for the people on Marine Avenue. And I would like to add one more thing. Unfortunately, this is Dan Miller right here. If it was Donald Bren, it would be a 3-story restaurant with a balcony with the outside dining. Thank you very much.
Hello. Okay. Can you hear me? Okay.
Yes.
Okay. My name is Lynn O'Brien, and my husband and I, Tom, have lived in our home at 105 Marine Avenue for 30 years, and we're opposed to the Village Inn's plan to establish an outdoor dining area in our residential block of Marine Avenue. Much has been said about how much the merchants appreciate and meet in the Village Inn, how we've heard from people who have lived in Newport Beach for many years, and how much they enjoy going to the Village Inn. And you know, that's why we people who live on Balboa Island live there. That is exactly why I live there, because I love the beach and I love it, and we used to be very frequent visitors of the Village Inn. However, this has become a terrible situation because it is the residential block of Marine Avenue. It is not the commercial block of Marine Avenue. It is, okay, dear, there we go. The VI's application to build this permanent, and it is permanent, it's a hulking structure, outdoor dining area that encroaches into the right-of-way and is enclosed by a 36-inch high wrought iron fence is an odious request because the proposed outdoor dining area would be only 40 feet from two of the nearest residential properties. There is a Title 20 planning and zoning part of the chapter of Newport Beach, section 20.50.080, paragraph 5, and it states that projects like this are meant to encourage the maintenance of a district neighborhood entity. Also, in that same title, in that same section, and in paragraph 3, it states projects of the nature of this outdoor dining are subject to review with the intent of ensuring a safe and convenient circulation for pedestrians and vehicles. The proposed area for the outdoor dining is too narrow to accommodate both the proposed dining area and also pedestrian traffic. I measured it the other day, and the 6 feet, the edge of the 6 feet, is right on the edge of the curb. Absolutely. I wonder if an ADA certified access specialist would agree that that 6 foot amount of sidewalk concrete is enough for a disabled person. In addition, some of the patrons will have those dogs out. Now, it is council policy, the council policy L21. I promise you, Mrs. McDermott had a long time to speak, so if you'll bear with me, thank you very much. Council policy L21 prohibits outdoor sidewalk dining within 10 feet of a crosswalk. According to the plans that we saw, that dining area is within 10 feet, and I did a measure of that, within 10 feet of a crosswalk. What I saw up here appeared different, so I don't know if something has been changed between when we saw the staff report and from today, tonight. Finally, the Village Inn occupies a two-story building that fronts on Park Avenue. Instead of encroaching into our neighborhood residential neighborhood, the owner could reinstate the original Village Inn addresses of 1307 and 1309, which are now nowhere to be found in the city records, and install those bifolding glass doors at the Park Avenue front of the restaurant. Those old doors are still there. Similar to what the new owner of the Royal Hen, formerly Amelia's, in the 300 block of Marine Avenue has done. And it's very effective because we had dinner there to sit with the doors open. It's pretty close to having outdoor dining. I must make a statement. Several years ago,
if you could please wrap it up.
Okay, yeah. All right.
Because you're past your time.
And it would be, at that way, it would be unnecessary to relocate the bike racks. Finally, this is just, I'm asking you to deny this petition because it is inappropriate for our neighborhood. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good evening, council members. My name is Brian Moss. I'm a 25-year resident of Orange County and manage a law office here in Newport Beach. Have four kids and have recently had the privilege of becoming a resident of the island. And I actually live on Marine Avenue. And I would be one of the only people, I guess, that would be here to tell you about what I hear on the sound on Marine Avenue.
Sir, what's your address?
I live at 112 Marine Avenue. And the way that my house is designed, my bedroom is on the front side of the house, on the street side of the house. And my window actually faces down towards Park Avenue. And I sleep with the window open, and I've been there for 2 months, albeit it's only 2 months, but I've been there for enough nights to know and hear the sounds of the Village Inn as well as the rest of the island and everything else that goes on. And literally I hear flip-flops going up and down the street in front of my house all night long, but I have never heard a sound come from the Village Inn. And I'm probably 6 to 7 houses down on the street, but I have had no problems. I've never heard a sound come through my window that was related to the Village Inn. I've heard the sirens go off from the firehouse. I've heard flip-flops walking up and down the street, heels, whatever. But I've never had any noise from the Village Inn. And I really believe that what I've seen in the proposal and looking at what they're doing to the Village Inn is going to enhance the character not only of the restaurant and of Marine Avenue and of the island and Orange County. And it's going to become a place where when you walk down that street and you have the opportunity to sit on the street and dine the way they have it designed, I really think it's going to be a huge improvement to the island. And I would support the application and ask your affirmative votes tonight. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. I live at 116 Marine Avenue. I was in a restaurant cocktail business for a long time. I wonder if the owner realizes when his employees tell the outside customers who have been drinking they have to go inside with their drinks and maybe food, there could be a big problem with 14 people trying to find a place for them to sit down. The owner does not have or need security in his restaurant now. Security will not be able to be everywhere if he has problems. The owner should also think about the firemen who live across the street from the Village Inn. Loud noise will be created from talking and when customers and employees constantly go in and out of the doors. We should all think about the firemen wherever we live, who sleep whenever they can, day or night, who work very hard to save all of our lives and our property. Thank you.
Okay, go ahead.
My name's Jay Truex. I'll start with that one. I don't know if the fire department has been here to complain about this issue or not. I don't think so, but I haven't heard anybody. One thing he mentioned was everyone's going to rush inside when they have to close the outdoor patio, and there's going to be fights and scrambles and, you know, dogs and whatever. But basically, Dan already said they're just going to hold entertainment till people finish their dinner and just kind of get them in. Also, it just seems like it's just the one street that complains about this. The place has been there since 1933. People moved to this island because it's convenient. You know, I've lived all over Laguna, Emerald Bay, born in LA, been coming here for years. I've lived on the little island for 22 years. And it's like I like it here because you can walk over a bridge. There used to be a bridge, and we have a temporary one now. But and you're downtown. You don't have to get in your car. You can get on your bike, go down to the ferry, ride to the peninsula. It's just so convenient. There's a lot of people that retire. They want to turn Balboa Island into like Leisure Island, where there's no fun. There's, you know, it's just quiet. I live on the little island. I have a house right across my alley where my bedroom is, and it's a rental. And they always rent to little kids. So there's bouncing balls, yelling and screaming. It's like I'm living in a playground. And they don't have any garages. People have built either apartments or laundry rooms. You know, they're not. They don't comply with the codes. But there's loud noises all over the place. We have planes fly over till 10 o'clock at night. And the fire department, you know, Dan's just trying to do something that people have, I've seen people come into that restaurant and walk out because there's no outdoor dining. People come to this island from all over the world for it's a destination for fun. And to spoil the fact that he wants to do something great, and they have done great work there, and all the stuff that people say, I can't even believe where they get it, because it's not it's nothing I've seen, I've heard. And I just believe that they should be able to do this and prosper. And there's plenty of room. There's no ADA accessibility impact with the sidewalk being 6 foot, whatever it is. And I just recommend approval, please.
Thank you. Let's try to wrap up public comments here. So can I see a show of hands of who's still? Okay. Go ahead, sir.
My name is Tim Hamilton. I'm a resident of Balboa Island. I've lived on Sapphire Avenue for the last 8 years and lived in Southern California for the last 32. I'm a real estate land acquisition consultant, and my projects include the St. Regis Hotel and Pacific City and Huntington Beach. And I've built a lot of residential developments next door to commercial. I'm here to support the Village Inn as a resident. And I go there 2 or 3 times a month. And I think we should support local business. We make it really hard for the Village Inn. I mean, I've been there many times when the staff have had to police the people who wanted to stand up and start dancing. And it's hard for these people. I think we have to make sure the doors are shut, and I think that's going to be an issue for them with the new improvement. I'm sympathetic to the residents down on Marine, and the owners are going to have to police what they do with those doors to make sure it isn't a big issue in the future. But it's an overall big improvement for the business. I think we're short of outdoor dining. We only have a few tables on the island that could be perceived as outside. Overall for Balboa Island, I think the negative impacts on the community are minimal, and I'd like to see you support it. I think the bike rack that used to have lots of dead bicycles on it that were chained up from people that never took them home really could go somewhere like across the road to the fire station. I heard today that the fire station was supportive and they have some space over there, and it would seem like a logical place to put it. I share some concern about putting them in the red zones as well as other residents. I think with having 16 chairs, I think it was. That's just 8 tables. I don't see that being a huge noise concern. I think it would be good for the community. I've spoken to a lot of people on the island who've thought it's a great idea, and I wish there was more of those local residents I spoke to here tonight, but the overall feeling that I got from the community was they were supportive, and I'd very much like your support as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Pat O'Sullivan, and I'm a retired Newport Beach police officer, 30 years. And I have been to the VI on numerous occasions in the past and have personal experience. I'm here today because I recently went over to Mike Sullivan's house, who lives on Marine, and witnessed and listened to at least 40 videos of violations which have occurred on primarily noise, and I know that's an issue tonight, that have occurred over the last 4 years. These violations are violations of the municipal code, the use permits, 415 of the penal code. I can't imagine why those videos have not been seen by everybody. They're very, very poignant, and they're very impressive. If I was a cop on the beat and I saw those violations, I would take action. So my opinion here tonight is that any additional noise would not be welcomed by any residents in the area. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Shane Sullivan. I live at 121 Marine Avenue with my sister, mom, and dad. I'm 12 years old. Since I've been 8 years old, the Village Inn's nightclub music has been disturbing my family. It's very annoying. It has been so loud that I couldn't even do my homework. Mostly it was the drums or the bass. The bass never stops, even when I try to sleep. Now, because they want something from you, they come here to say that they have lowered their volume. Not true in my house. Just 2 days ago, we heard music inside our living room. This is my dad's iPhone. When music gets real loud, he goes outside and stands on the curb and records their band music on video. The law says their music must stay inside their building. Here's a recent example. Listen.
Okay.
Outside the restaurant.
And if you wanted to see the back of that, that was taken outside the restaurant.
Wait, sir. Sir, excuse me. Yeah.
Gentlemen, my name is Mike Sullivan, and I've lived on Belleville Island for 38 years. This is the tip of the iceberg. For 4 years, we've been listening to that out on the street, in our house, in my children's bedroom. I know we've heard from code enforcement over here. We gave up on code enforcement 4 years ago because we told them everything that they were doing, and we got nothing in return. We told the police department what was happening. We got nothing. So we had to do it ourselves. This is what we had to do. I've notified every gentleman up here that we have over 40, probably 60 tapes, just as shocking as this one, taken from inside my house, with my windows closed, doors closed, music you could not believe. I've offered it to you. You haven't taken the opportunity to listen to it yet. Got another 40 or 50 from out on the street. And it's shocking. Municipal code says, in order to get an entertainment permit in this city, part of the condition is the music must be contained within your building. If you're going to violate that rule, such a simple rule, then you don't deserve special privileges like outdoor dining. They violate, my wife listed off so many of the use code, use permit violations. They have deliveries for the last 4 years. Deliveries at 3 and 4 a.m. in the alley behind our house. Our next-door neighbor who lives upstairs continually says she hears people vomiting at all hours of the morning behind their Village Inn customers, people arguing, and then she has to put up with these massive Cisco trucks with the beep, beep, beep. The backup always wakes her up. Last week it was 3:15 in the morning. She went and yelled out her bathroom window, could you please stop? He was making so much noise, he couldn't hear her to stop. Anyway, that was not what I came to say. But you haven't taken me up on my offer to listen to these recordings of so many violations. There are recordings in here of people dancing out on the street to the music that they heard in the Village Inn. There are recordings in here of people jumping up on the stage and dancing with the band. There's one recording in here where the entire restaurant got up on its feet, screaming and hollering with the band. And this is what I put up with my family. I'm trying to raise 2 school-aged children. This is what we put up with. This is a deliberate violation of common decency that they have foisted on us in our neighborhood. And yes, many of the people who have spoken here in favor of the Village Inn don't live anywhere near us, so they have no idea what we've been going through. I hold no hard feelings. Unless you live near this, you would have no idea what this has done to my family. So if they can't follow those simple rules, now we have several speakers that can't speak tonight because last week there was a surprise continuance. So I have something else that I need to say, and I'd like to take up one of their spaces because
I'm sorry, it doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way.
All right,
okay, you've had your time. Thank you.
Darren Friend, and I'm sorry I didn't prepare any kind of a written statement, but I've lived on the island and owned property for 39 years and seen a lot of different owners of the Village Inn. And I would say that the Village Inn has never been any more quiet than it is now. What Dan and his family have done, they don't have drums. They don't even have big bands there anymore. They have like a guitarist that maybe has some sort of a instrumental thing that's in the background, but I would say from everything that I've seen there that they've done everything they can to keep it quiet. And I even walked by there on Halloween the other night and I never heard a noise. But what I'd like to say to Ellis, number one, who lives across the street, when you tore your house down,
you have to address the commission.
Okay. When he tore his house down, and he lives right across the street, and put up a whole block wall, did he ask anybody if they cared if his house looked like a crematorium or a mausoleum or Alcatraz? No. And as far as Sullivan goes, he inherited that house when his parents died and lived around the Village Inn for probably longer than 39 years. So he already knew what the Village Inn was. So if he wasn't happy with it when he inherited it, why didn't he just sell it? And he never had a problem when his kids were playing in the front yard next door until Dan bought it and said, you can't do that anymore. I know you did.
Excuse
me. I know
me.
The kids played
Excuse
there.
Me. You have,
so anyway,
you have a minute.
I'm just saying that this is the most considerate owner I think the Village Inn has ever had.
Order, please. I think it's time for us to wrap up public comments here, so this is going to be the last one.
Charles Kinsler, I'm the owner of the property. Me and my wife own it. I think it was important. We received a letter of support from the actual closest neighbor to the Village Inn, and that is from Todd and Shannon Keller. They live at 305 Park, which is right across from the alley, about 15 feet. They've owned the home for 4 years. It's the famous Ann Lemon House, and I don't know those of you that go back to Village Inn lore. There was a famous case that harassment case with Ann Lemon, which is sort of similar to what the Sullivans are putting Dan through. Went all the way to the California Supreme Court, and the Village Inn won that case, 2004. To just read the middle part of this, in the 4 years we have owned the home directly next door to the Village Inn, we have never had any issues or problems with the restaurant. Shannon, myself, and our tenants have had a very positive impression of the restaurant and have eaten there over the years and feel very favorable in its reviews. Even though they have live music, the noise has never been an issue, and in fact, we have never heard the music. You can even walk in the restaurant when the doors are closed, you cannot hear the live music, which is still unbelievable to me. I know the owners have gone to great lengths to make sure that the noise level is not an issue to the neighbors' homes, none of which are closer than ours. They have done an outstanding job controlling the noise level, and I feel as though they have been through making sure that the changes are that they do are not negatively impacting the neighborhood. Dan is an upstanding and outstanding businessman. It goes on to say that they're thankful that Dan owns the restaurant, and that they would definitely urge your support. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else? Okay. Is there anyone else besides him? If so, line up in the middle here. Just line up, and then that's the line, and then we're done.
Okay. Hi, my name...
Go ahead.
My name is Don Abrams. I live on the island, and I have a real estate firm on the island. I'd like to address... the bike rack first. The idea to put them in the crosswalks to me is a terrible idea, including putting them right in front of my office. We watch all that crosswalk all day. Cars are skidding to a halt. People are trying to get across the street. And putting them in the crosswalk, to me, would make it a more dangerous area. So I definitely don't think that. And on the other side of the street is St. John Vianney Church, which is also heavily trafficked. I can't imagine putting bike racks in front of the church. So I think you'd need to come up with a better place for the bike racks. I also live at 200 Grand Canal, which is right across the bridge from the Village Inn. So that's maybe 3 or 4 blocks away, but it's all open air. And the Village Inn does have quite a bit of noise. In the summertime, when people are coming in and out at night, we can actually hear voices coming in and out at night. It's not terribly disturbing, but we definitely hear it 3 or 4 blocks away. The problem I have with this idea is that it's not the 16 people sitting outside that are going to create the noise. It's all the people who are inside having these doors open. I go to the Village Inn. I love Dan Miller and his family. I also know the Bergmans, the Morcos, the Sullivans. They're all great people. It's just that the neighbors, including myself, 3 or 4 blocks away, are the ones who would have to live with loud noise. It's hard for me to imagine 7 o'clock in the morning having people sitting out at those tables while the Morcoses and the Bergmans are trying to get a good morning sleep, or people trying to go to sleep at night, and really having the whole Village Inn open with 36 feet. So I just don't see how this is workable the way it is. I think I'm sympathetic to Dan, and I'm sympathetic to all the neighbors, myself included. What I suggest is perhaps Dan and the neighbors could all have a friendly meeting, because this hasn't been very friendly. Perhaps in my office, I'd like to invite everyone over. And maybe there's a more workable solution than the one that's here, because I just don't see that these twains are not meeting. This is a tough issue. I don't know how you can find this is for the betterment or benefit of the community. I'm sympathetic to Dan because I think he's been a great operator. I go to the Village Inn. I like to eat there. Like I said, it is noisy, though, and opening those doors 36 feet would be opening the whole Village Inn to the community. So that's what I want to say.
Good evening. Good evening, Chair Kramer and fellow commissioners. Steve Rozanski, President and CEO of the Newport Beach Chamber of Commerce. I'm just here to support the project. I know Dan Miller, and I believe that they're good operators of that property. I think you've heard it from many of the people who have spoken tonight that probably one of the best operators in a long time there. They've offered to make significant improvements to the building. They've agreed to other restrictions on their operation there, reducing the number of musicians and other things like that. We have noise ordinances in place in town that if it does become a problem, they are enforceable. We do have code enforcement. And I think one of the most important things that we really haven't heard much about tonight is the fact that they've agreed to the operator's license, which the city council put into place a few years back. And very few restaurants have agreed to that. And it does serve as a break on restaurants and bars in town that if they do not comply with the conditions of the operator's license, it can be pulled, which does affect their use permit as well. So it's an extra tool that the city has to prevent a conduct that even if you didn't do anything, even if they were just trying to operate it as it is and they violated the operator's license, it would significantly restrict their business more so than it would today without the operator's license. So I encourage you to give strong consideration to the project, and hopefully you will vote for approval. Thank you.
My name is Jim Simpkins, and I live at 116 Onyx Avenue, which is 4 houses down on the alley from the VI. I've lived there for 5 years, and I've never once heard anything come out of the VI at any time of the day. Dan Miller, that I know, is a man of character. I suggest that the people from Marine should sit down and work it out with him, because I think the commissioners here all need facts, and I don't think there's been a lot of emotion here tonight, but not a lot of facts. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Is there anyone else?
My name is Susan Bartoletti, and I have been living on the island and within a mile of the island for 37 years. And I do my evening walks from about 10 p.m. to 1 a.m., almost seven nights a week. I never hear any loud music coming outside of the Village Inn. But I think one of the things everybody's missing is that everything on the island, when people move there, and most of these people moved after the Village Inn was built, but the whole island, when you move there, you know that you can hear everybody. You can hear your neighbor. You can hear their TV. You can smell the food that comes in your window from their window. That's the nature of the island. Everybody is close to everybody. You know that going into it. The people that live four or five doors from the Village Inn, they moved on a mixed-use street. I think if someone wanted to live in the middle of nowhere, they would live on a farm in South Dakota somewhere if they don't want to be friendly with people. And I think I give Dan kudos for going through all of this process just so people can enjoy dining outside. And I'm sure there are millions of people that would love the opportunity to live in those houses a few doors away from Marine Avenue. And I wish they would give them the chance if these people are unhappy living there. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. Okay, is there anyone else? Okay, if not, bring it back to the applicant for closing comments or rebuttal.
Thank you very much. We certainly regret that our neighbors are opposed to what we're trying to do with all of the efforts we're making to sound attenuate the building and noise studies that are trying to prove that it's going to be much better than it was. I did want to say one thing. In terms of a sign against dancing, that is a condition of our entertainment permit. That has to be in the restaurant. And when you have nice music, even if it's mellow, sometimes people want to dance. And so we have to enforce that. And that's the reason for the sign. With regard to the bike racks not guaranteed, the fact is they're not owned by the city. They are on city right-of-way. We've researched. Nobody knows who owns the bike racks. But we're willing to relocate them. There's a condition of approval. And the city staff, Tony Bryan sitting here as city traffic engineer, is going to have to agree on the safety and the element and where it's going to be, and it's going to be well handled. However, it can only be done once that has been agreed to. And so different opinions are going to prevail, but the fact that it's not guaranteed doesn't mean that it won't happen prior to the time that we open our doors. The other thing is that I will say that we are in the mixed-use portion of Marine Avenue because it's the fire station on one side and the Village Inn on the other, and that is the mixed-use portion. And then, admittedly, there is residences beyond that point, but it's not completely a residential street, or the Village Inn would not have been there for 80 years, and the fire station would have not been built at that location. So we will continue to note that our dining area is going to be 37, 60, and 75 feet away from our three nearest neighbors. So the dimensions that have been listed by some speakers were really quite erroneous. And I would just once again indicate that we're willing to work with you on conditions of approval, and we very much are willing to be a good neighbor in the community. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay, the public hearing is closed. Bring it back to the commission. For discussion? Yeah, Commissioner Zach.
Just a question for staff. One of the people from the public, Mr. Zansky, spoke about operator's license, and is that in the conditions? Did the applicant was willing to accept that? I didn't see that. Can you steer me in the right direction?
It is a condition of approval on the basis that they are amending their use permit, and they already are open beyond 11 p.m. They are required to obtain a use permit, an operator's license, and the condition is number 23. Thank you, Michael.
So can you just explain what that additional license provides the city in terms of enforcement? And
Sure. The operator's license is required and is actually issued by the police department, the chief police officer. So I'll let Wendy Jo respond to the details of it.
The spirit of the operator license is basically to support the CUP and to give enforcement some teeth should there be a problem. I think Commissioner Wigan brought up in past sessions that the CUP, when it stands alone, the fines are minimal, $100, they're on a scale, but they don't really create any sort of impact. So the operator license was created so that should the police experience a problem, we could then remove their ability to serve alcohol after 11 p.m. or remove their ability to serve alcohol with live entertainment. Did I say a.m.? I meant p.m.
Yeah, no, that's helpful.
Okay. Commissioner Lawler?
Could enforcement or the police department respond to the video and just to, obviously we all heard that and there's other evidence. How is that not a violation and what triggers a violation? How does that work? Because I think a lot of people in the public, you know, heard that and it seems like it would be a violation, but how is it not? And when do you go and maybe give us some flavor on all that?
I'll start and I'll actually turn it over to Cassie Palmer. I'm disheartened. The police department hasn't seen those videos. This is the first I've heard of a video existing. Like I said, we've been out on numerous occasions. In 2015, due to the application, we made, like I said, you know, 8 self-initiated responses and visits to the Village Inn trying to support what the neighbors were saying, and we just couldn't find evidence to support it. That evidence could be helpful, especially if they could anticipate what nights would be problematic. But we don't hear. In 2016, like I said, we've had 2 complaints to the police department. So as far as we're concerned, we don't know any or have any evidence that there's a significant problem. So maybe Cassie could speak to something different.
Actually, I'm going to step in here because I have reviewed the videos that Mr. Sullivan was speaking to. I reviewed them with the assistant city manager, Carol Jacobs, I guess it was a couple weeks ago. And he presented to us a series of videos that went back to several years ago. And the ones that are the oldest are ones that were taken from within his residence. And it was apparent that he could hear the noise at that level. The ones that we were most interested in, the ones that were more recent, and those were taken right outside the establishment. He was standing on the sidewalk and videotaping what was occurring inside. And it was, in fact, you could hear the music from the sidewalk, but that is not a violation in itself. Mr. Sullivan several times mentioned that referred to a code section 5.28 of the municipal code, and that section does talk about sound levels not emanating beyond the building edge. However, this live entertainment permit qualifies that, stating that in order to demonstrate compliance with that code section is in fact relating to another condition that says it shall not exceed 60 decibels on the public sidewalk. So the noise can be heard on the sidewalk and still not be a violation of the code. So although the videos, it was audible from the outside, it was difficult to tell whether or not it actually exceeded that decibel level. So the city maintains we have not been able to document any violations.
And I'll just add that we recently did our restaurant and bar checks just this last week, and it was out there Friday where we do the sound readings and go out there. And as Brenda mentioned, when the ambient noise would drop down, then that's when you could barely hear them. The ambient noise exceeds the interior noise by far. So when a car's not going by, when people weren't, you know, outside walking by, then you could hear that there was some noise. With regard to the videos, unfortunately, the complaints that were brought to code enforcement's attention were also brought to our attention 4 or 5 years after. So there's been a lot of videos and photographs, even some comments from the public today about bar stools and the property maintenance. Those are photographs submitted to our division within the last year of complaints that had happened 4, 5, 6 years ago. So there hasn't been, as of today, where we've stood out there, we've done some measurements, and it was a violation of the sound ordinance.
Cassie, just a follow-up on that. Do you, in your expert opinion, if you were out there at a time, as per the video that we heard, would that be a violation based on the noise coming from the restaurant?
It's very difficult. I don't want to speculate here. The situation, I mean, part of some of the other concerns code enforcement receives is like lighting, for instance. So when I'm out there, if somebody snaps a photograph of you know, shining, blaring light within their dwelling unit, it's my job to go out there and respond and then take a look to see if it actually is a violation. So it's difficult to, you know, listen to a video without actually having been there and to review that evidence. So I really can't say if that's a violation without actually standing there with my sound reader.
It's fair, but it could be or it could not be. It's just, it's hard. It's, we just can't speculate this time, correct?
Exactly.
Okay. Commissioner Holgren?
Tony, comments were made about the safety of the bike racks and placement of bike racks. Where are we in the process? And does it really take 4 months to get these things in place? It seems like a pretty simple solution to me.
Well, we've only just started reviewing the locations. I know I've heard comments to the effect that there's concerns about the visibility of the crosswalks if the racks were put immediately adjacent to it. And we share that concern, so we're starting to look at where they could be to maximize visibility and lessen any impact to parking, that type of thing. So we've only started looking at that. As far as actually installing them, once we order them, it's a matter of how long it takes to get the racks and then how long it takes to get a contractor to install them. So, I mean, we're estimating that we think we can get them in 4 months, but we've never done bike corrals in the city before, so we're not certain exactly how long it would take.
What's the process just to get to approval? Is there involvement with the local merchants association and residents, or is it something that you take on and everybody's going to be after your head, or what's the...
We're going to verify with the Merchants Association. We've heard that they've approved it. We're going to follow up and verify with them that they do support it, and then, you know, we'll go from there.
And then a comment made about the sidewalk width, the remainder, and concerns about ADA. Is that a concern?
The minimum ADA requirement width for a sidewalk is 48 inches, so it's 4 feet. And that's the minimum federal requirement. So a six-foot-wide sidewalk is beyond the minimum ADA.
And we'll have a six-foot-wide remaining sidewalk once that seating area is in place. We'll still have 6 feet.
Right. It'll remain as a six-foot clear sidewalk as proposed.
Okay, great. Thanks.
Okay. Is there a motion? Okay, thank you. Please,
yeah,
thank
this,
you.
This is a tough one. I think we were up here before you, I guess it was last December, and I was one of the ones who voted against it. And one of the reasons why was we have to make certain findings when issuing a conditional use permit. One of those findings speaks specifically to the general welfare or persons residing or working in the neighborhood of the proposed use. And, you know, a lot of the folks that were here tonight that spoke against this live right adjacent to it. And so they're the ones that are most, you know, most impacted, and I hear them. On the flip side, when look, I think most of us up here really want the businesses in the city to thrive. And but on the flip side, my very first question I asked tonight was, could the Village Inn make modifications just through renovation and open up that wall and redo their windows, and as long as they weren't putting the seating out there, and essentially have the same indoor outdoor dining effect? And and the answer was yes. And so taking that into account and then weighing everything that was was presented tonight and all the positives, I think there's a lot more positives here than just saying no, because the building's going to be upgraded substantially. We've got a lot by issuing this permit. You not only now do you have an operator's license, but there's a lot more restrictions on the business. There's like condition 14 limits the number of seats. Condition 16 stipulates the STC ratings of the doors. Conditions 17 and 18 are detailed recommendations for noise attenuation and upgrading the building. Throughout the entire building, not just against that wall. Condition number 19 reduces the number of musicians that are allowed to play at the Village Inn. Condition 33, we talked about the relocation of the bike racks, which I think everyone is in favor of. I know that the question of where they would be relocated is still at issue, but relocating from their current place. You're going to get an upgraded landscaping feature at the end of Marine Drive there. The applicant also offered another condition about deliveries early in the morning. And I would, if the commission wants to consider approving this tonight, I would recommend that we include that condition. I'd also like to recommend to my fellow commissioners the consideration of an additional condition of approval, which I drafted prior to the meeting and kind of thinking it through if this was where this was going to head. And I don't know where the rest of you are, but I think Brenda, I've got to pass out, and I think Brenda, you have that. We can put that up on the. And the condition actually deals with the fact that the noise study that was done, it's a computer model like we talked about. And again, intuitively, I just struggle with the fact that it's not going to be above those thresholds. But, you know, it's an expert, and they've done a report. So what this condition says is within 3 months of certificate of occupancy and full operation of the outdoor dining, the applicant shall undertake actual noise measurements, and that could be the applicant or the city, I guess, whatever the commission would like, of the noise generated by the outdoor dining. The analysis shall be considered by the Planning Commission at a noticed public hearing to ensure compliance with conditions of approval and the city's noise ordinance. Modifications to the conditions of approval may be required if the project is not in compliance. You know, a lot of this, we deal with land use issues and the issuance of these permits. And then there's a whole separate thing that's really not in our purview is enforcement. But we do get updated on whether or not the conditions of approval that we attach to these conditions are being upheld. So that's kind of where I'm at. And I'd like to hear what the other commissioners think about that added condition and just their thoughts in general.
Go ahead, Brad.
Mr. Chair, thanks. I'm a huge fan of outdoor dining in Newport Beach. I think it's something that benefits everybody, and I always seek to try and figure out how to support that. I've met with the applicant's representative, and I believe that this is, when we talk about opening up the sidewalk for public use, we're providing a gift of real estate that is owned by the residents of the city. And I have an expectation that when we do that, we get something back. I think there are some benefits to this proposal for sure. I had asked the applicant, or at least the applicant's representative, if we're going to do this, do it right, do it well. This is the kind of end cap for the commercial district in Balboa. I heard landscape for the first time tonight that there was going to be some enhancement. I think it's important that it looks well. I think the wrought iron fencing looks cheap. I don't think it looks appropriate in terms of creating the kind of environment if we really want to have a great kind of end piece. So my encouragement would be a condition that would require some enhancement to that outdoor dining area. I think the fact that there are some good trade-offs to this thing, I think that the new doors will provide sound attenuation. So when it's closed, I think that's going to be a benefit to the community. I think the bike racks are actually going to be located in a smarter location for all of the island. And I think the operator license does, well, what we can do is put in place opportunities for enforcement, and this permit requires that. And I would encourage those that if you have problems with the noise, don't stop calling code enforcement. You have people here that are interested in hearing the concerns and want to respond and want to react. And it sounds to me like we have an applicant that wants to be a good neighbor and will try and figure out how to solve it if there is an issue. But if somebody says, look, I'm not going to call, I'm just going to bring a video to the next time there's a public hearing, that doesn't help anybody. That doesn't get it solved. And I think that there needs to be an active engagement if there really is that issue. And I think the sound is going to be better. And I think having a requirement to actually test it after it's open is a terrific idea. So that's where I sit with this.
So I too voted against this the last time, and I'm extremely, and I think the commission was and is very sympathetic to the Sullivans and the other neighbors in the area. And I recall a lot of the reasons the commission, or at least myself, voted against this the last time. There's issues with noise and the bike racks. There's just a lot of unanswered questions on the encroachment, if I remember correctly. And I think the applicant, I'm struggling, but I think the applicant has made great strides since we met the last time. I think there are very, as Commissioner Zach pointed out, there are very robust conditions of approval. The improvements to the property are very significant. The noise study, we have to, you know, I'm very focused on us not speculating and us looking at the facts, and the facts are the noise studies are such, and we have to live by that. I think it's incumbent for us all to vote on the facts and not speculation or opinion. This is clearly consistent with the land use element 5.3.4. I think Commissioner Zach's additional condition of approval is appropriate, and it gives the neighbors a chance along the city and everyone to make sure this is right. And I think Commissioner Hilgren's comment and condition of approval to ensure that the landscape is adequate, and it really takes in account the fact that the city is indeed giving something up here, is appropriate as well. And so I, despite my previous no vote, I do think that the applicant has made great strides, and I tend to agree with Commissioner Zach and Hilgren.
I too was a no vote, and you know, looking at the applicant, I think they've worked hard here. I know I feel for the residents on some of this here, but you know, the applicant has agreed to one less musician. The sound attenuation that the new walls will provide will be beneficial. I was, during that last hearing, really you know, upset about the bike racks. In fact, the last staff report that we saw included the bike racks going to the neighboring property. And, you know, I probably blew a gasket and yelled at staff and probably shouldn't have gotten too aggressive on that. But the fact that...
I wasn't at that meeting, so I missed that.
That we worked hard here to find a new location for them. While that hasn't been determined, there's a general idea to move them off the 100 block. And I think that's beneficial for the residents, that these folks won't, that come out of the Village Inn will be smoking and loitering and making loud ruckus trying to get their combination figured out. And I think moving those further down to where more businesses are on Marine, I think that's beneficial to the community and something that I think this will be a positive for the whole city to spin, to say that we're promoting more bike use in our community. And Balboa Island is a fixture in our city, and people think of Balboa Island when they think of tourism in our city. So we want to be promoting bicycle tourism, I think, more so than car. There's only so many car spaces to park on the island. And while I get that there's residential there, it's also a major tourism component to the city and the city's history and the city's future. So the fact that we have an operator's license here with the police department, you know, that's a lot of risk for the Village Inn here. And the council still has to approve encroachment to give that public right-of-way spaceway and to approve the bike rack relocation here. So what we're simply doing here is step one. There's many more steps along the way that I think the Village Inn has to come with and prove themselves and work with the city on. And then one other thing, too, that was brought up, the existing permit restricts deliveries between 10 p.m. and 8 a.m. So if there's violations there, the city needs to be called and be told that there's a problem. So they shouldn't be delivering anything before 8 a.m. I want to see some type of, and I agree with the commissioner's additional conditions, but some type of update maybe. Not that it's, I just want to see some type of update on where those bike racks are being placed. I think it's important for us to know progress on it. I know that the applicant has asked for the 120 days. I'm not quite there on supporting that. I do support the initial part of their request for the effective date. The beginning part of the condition there, the applicant shall submit $12,000 to the City of Newport within 30 days of the effective date, the City Council authorization. So I'm supportive of that, but just not the 120 days, because I don't want to displace the bike racks without actually finding a home for the bike racks. So I don't want people floating around, locking them up to signs and locking them up to fences and locking them up to places they shouldn't be. So I wouldn't be supportive of that. But everything else that the commission has said, the commissioners have added to, I would be supportive.
Okay, thank you. I think the conditions of approval here are key. They're important, obviously, in every application, but particularly in this one. So I encourage, the eventual motion maker to include all the various ideas that we've discussed here tonight to bolster the overall conditions of approval. Obviously, all commercial property uses are required to comply with city noise regulations. The Village Inn has to comply with noise ordinance, and not doing so is a code enforcement action, not a denial on the outset of a valid use. Something we have to be cognizant of. There's often this tension between residential and commercial. I've been on the Planning Commission for 6 years, and this is not the first time this has happened. It's quite common. And so there's always a struggle there between the residential and commercial uses, particularly where those uses intersect. There may be an occasional inconvenience for those residents that are close to commercial uses. Commercial uses, modify over time to meet market demands, but as long as the use complies with the rules, those uses should be accommodated, and the city must enforce those rules. So with that, I would like to have, I think Commissioner Zach, you're probably the most prepared to make a motion that includes the various requests from the other commissioners.
Just a couple questions before I do that. One, Commissioner Hilgren, can you clarify what the condition was you wanted on the landscape and the patio treatment, which I totally agreed with, by the way?
I don't think the commission needs to see the landscape plan for that. I would leave that up to staff, but I think that area should be landscaped in a sufficient manner.
And approved by the Director of Community Development?
Oh, be fine.
Okay. Brenda, can you craft something up that will comply with what Commissioner Hilgren's asking for?
Of course. I also heard something about the railing. Did you want the railing to be more detailed in style? Or
I would encourage them to improve that, but as it sits, if it's landscape, that's going to help a lot.
Oh, here it is. Okay, and then what was the other question? Commissioner Wigand brought up a good point about the, there's already a city ordinance about deliveries. So the applicant had recommended something that they couldn't do deliveries before 6 a.m., but there's already ordinance that allow, you can't do it before 8 a.m.?
Actually, an existing use permit is more restrictive than what the applicant was proposing, and which it would apply now, which limits them from 8 a.m.
Okay.
So that would stand.
Okay. And then, so we don't need to add anything there because we've already.
No, you don't. That.
Okay. And then the revisions to the bike rack condition, I agreed with Commissioner Wigand to accept the applicant's revision to the very first part, but not the last part of the condition. Did the rest of you agree with that as well?
So you agree on the effective date, but not the 120-day limitation?
Yes.
We ought to figure out how to get it done promptly. So is there an outside date? I mean, I can't imagine why it takes this long other than... Tony. That's why I was asking the question to Tony.
Well, I think that right now the four-month time period is our best estimate, and we're going to make every effort that we can to get those bike corrals in that four-month period. But it's hard for me to tie my hands and say commit to that time period without having that experience of putting them in before.
Commissioner Wigand, are you comfortable with an outside date of 6 months?
I just don't want to see a period where we have bike racks or no bike. We have bikes, but no bike racks. And the people will lock them to people's fences and the street signs, and they will become a nuisance. So I want to see something that's a little more firm that I feel for the applicant. I don't want you guys to be, you know, sitting there waiting for the city to do something. But there's got to be something we can work with here that I don't want to see bikes just floating around here in the neighborhood. They need to have a home, and there's got to be a place on Marine for them that is not at the 100 block. And maybe there is some room at the fire station, or maybe there's something on Park Avenue in front of the Village Inn or somewhere. There could be a combination up and down that area, but we need to have something comprehensive for our community, and the city needs to have a bit of tourism for bicycles and pedestrians and a good combination there. And we need to have something, a home for them. So
I don't have a hang up on this bicycle thing. I mean, no one really even knows how they got there to begin with. Right. So I think it'd be not necessarily prudent to tie this whole thing to the bike rack thing. So I don't know.
I think to me 6 months seems appropriate.
Is that something reasonable? That do you think? You're the public works expert, so
I wouldn't have a problem with us putting a 6 month period on it. I'm confident that we can do the 4 month, but I just can't commit to a time period. But I think I'm much more comfortable with a 6 month period. I do believe we can get it in the 4 month.
Attorney Torres, is that, you know, are we in a gray area here, or, you know, what do we see here with the 6 months? Can we come back within 4 months and say where we're at in progress? And if we have to extend,
well, Commissioner Wigand, I think ultimately staff's recommendation is what it is, to tie the bicycle racks, the removal to the installation of the new bicycle racks, to make sure there is no overlap. So I think staff would stick with that recommendation.
Which is not part of the 120 or 6 months.
Exactly, no time period. But the goal being, as Mr. Bryan said, to do it as quickly as possible.
No, my only problem with it is that, you know, part of this approval is, and part of the positives that I am thinking through this and supporting this, is the removal of the bike racks from where they are right now. So, you know, here we're going to let them get issued a building permit and go, and then the bike racks are still going to be there, and we don't know how long they're going to be there for. So that's my thought process. So it's like, but I don't want to hang them up either. So that's kind of, So what if the city doesn't perform within 6 months? Yeah, well.
It seems to me like the 6 months is a fair compromise. I mean, the bike racks were an issue the last time this came. They're an issue now. I understand that no one knows where they came from, but the flip side is, I mean, I'd be amazed if we couldn't get this done in 6 months. I think I would hope the applicant would agree with the 6 months, and I think at least I would support that on your motion.
I'm fine with that. I mean, I think there's all kinds of things that can come up in terms of solutions for that. So that's not the issue here tonight.
All right, so we'll go 6 months. And then on my condition, can we change that to say that instead of the applicant taking the actual noise measurements, that the city would? Brenda, was that acceptable? And are you guys all good with that?
Yeah, I'm assuming that would be at the applicant's cost.
Yes.
Okay.
And those times that the noise studies will be done won't be announced, but they'll be on weekend times or, you know, Friday, Saturday times that...
We'll include a range to demonstrate the typical activity.
Okay, with those added conditions of approval and amendments to the ones we've discussed, I propose a resolution of the Planning Commission of the City of Newport Beach approving use permit number UP2016-012 to establish an outdoor dining area associated with an existing restaurant at 127 Marine Avenue.
Is there a second?
Second.
One quick thing. I just want to make sure that, you know, are we going to be coming back, you know, in 4 months with just an update? A hearing or anything. I just want to get some type of update where we're at on the bikes, just so we know, you know, are we going to make that 6 month time frame?
Yeah, I would have no problem coming back to the commission just providing an update or hopefully just to say they're in.
Or just to say where we're at on it in 4 months.
Absolutely.
Okay.
So does the applicant agree with these conditions of approval in totality? Okay. All right, there is a second, so call for a vote.
Motion carries 5-0.
Thank you. Thank you. Next item is item number 5, motion for reconsideration. Meeting is still in progress. If you need to leave, please go quietly. Motion for reconsideration? None. Item number 6 is Community Development Director's Report.
So,
somebody left a phone up here.
Please, sir.
Somebody left a phone up here.
Please don't disturb the meeting. It's in progress. Thank you.
I thought it was on, so.
Just give it to staff. Thank you. Community Development Director's Report.
So, Director's Reports, I just want to direct you to the tentative agenda which you have before you. The City Council on Tuesday, if you haven't heard, the AutoNation application was withdrawn. So, the Planning Commission's decision to deny that project stands. Also, on November...
Excuse me, if you have... Please leave the chamber if you're not staying here. If you have other business, please take it outside. Please do so quietly. The meeting is still in progress.
Also, November 7th, the council will be hearing the adoption of the local coastal program for the first time. We had a study session with them at their last meeting, and it went very well. So, and tomorrow, the Coastal Commission is actually voting on our categorical exclusion order. So the motion is going in the right direction for us to have the LCP and actually start implementing coastal development permits early next year. So you also want to note the council meeting next week is actually going to be held on Monday rather than Tuesday. They rescheduled that to accommodate the election that's on Tuesday. And so Planning Commission, our next meeting is November 17th. And we have a few items on that meeting. And as you saw from our emails, I won't go over their December meeting, but we will be canceling the December 22nd and the January 5th meeting. So we'll have a little bit of break over the holidays. And that's all I have to report.
Great. Thank you very much. Announcements on matters that the Planning Commission members would like placed on a future agenda for discussion, action, or report. Any requests for excused absences? Are you happy that we're taking two meetings off, Brent? Okay. You want to retire? All right. Your term's coming up pretty soon, isn't it? Okay. All right. No requests for excused absences? Okay. The meeting is adjourned.